welcome to Snap's Biology. If you like my video, hit like, share with others, subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon so that you never miss an update. In the last part, we saw various ways in which the living organisms respond to abiotic conditions. Those responses were like to regulate or to conform. We also talk of some organisms, they migrate and some suspend their metabolic activities so that they are able to cope up with those abiotic conditions. Now, whenever we are talking about all those things, whether it is regulation or migration or conformation, anything, these are actually adaptation. So, because of these adaptations, these organisms are able to respond to this abiotic condition. So, all those responses are actually because of these various adaptations. Okay, so this adaptation can be morphological. That means there are some structural change which would help the organism to survive in those conditions. Second, the adaptation can be physiological. That means there can be some process change, some physiological change which would help this organism to survive. Third, it can be behavioral. The behavior of organism might change whenever the conditions change. So to understand this, we will take some examples and we will see how these adaptations have helped to cope up with the abiotic conditions. So the first example is kangaroo rat. It is found in North American deserts. It is found in a condition where water is scarce. It is a tiny animal. How has it survived in extremely dry condition? So it has certain adaptation. One adaptation is that kangaroo rats can survive without drinking water. Water is essential for various metabolic activities, but they survive without drinking it. But water is required. So from where are they getting this water? They get water by oxidation of fat. And this water is called metabolic water. That means in their entire life, they never drink water. They survive only on this metabolic water. So water which is produced by metabolic reactions like breakdown of fat, they are able to use this for various activities. So this is an adaptation. This adaptation can be long-term adaptation, short-term adaptation, but they are helping these animals to survive. The other adaptation which is seen in kangaroo rats is they excrete highly concentrated urine because it is a mammal and is uricotelic. To eliminate urea, a significant amount of water is required. So they are able to concentrate their urine to great extent, and if they excrete concentrated urine, that means water content which is lost is very less. So these adaptations are helping the kangaroo rats to survive in extreme dry condition where the water is limited. Clear? One more adaptation where the animals producing toxin or poisons. Example, snakes, spiders, frogs, scorpions. So this is also a physiological adaptation. Okay. Now we will talk about few more examples. The animals which are living in the colder regions, they have smaller extremities. Extremities means the structures which are sort of protruding from the body. So we including pinna, snouts and arms. So the animals which are living in the colder region, they would have smaller pinna as compared to the animals living in the warmer region. So if we are compared the foxes which are living in the colder region and foxes which are living in the warmer region, we will find foxes which are found in the warmer condition in desert region, their pinnas are much bigger, their snout is much bigger and their legs also bigger. The reason is that the maximum heat radiation takes place from the extremities. That means maximum heat loss would takes place from these structures. So if the pinna is bigger, more heat from the body will be lost. So animals living in warmer region would want that all that extra heat should get radiated, whereas the animals living in colder region, they would want all that heat to be conserved in their body. Minimum should be lost. So they have smaller extremities. And this adaptation is known as Allen's rule. A similar rule which was given by another scientist, it is known as Bergman's rule. Both tells us the same thing, that animals living in warmer condition would have bigger extremities and animals living in colder would have smaller extremities. Clear? Another adaptation which is named after the scientist and it is called Glauger's rule. According to this adaptation, the animals living around equator where the solar intensity is comparatively higher, they have darker skin or fur color. This is an adaptation. The animals live in or around equator area, they should have darker color. Here the solar intensity is more and we know that melanin pigment protect us from the harmful radiation. So if the solar intensity is more, the chances are that we would be harmed by those radiations. So we have more and more melanin synthesized. Now there are two aspects of this. The animals which lives in these areas, they would have darker skin color and the same, but the short term adaptation takes place when we get exposed to sunlight, and that is what is known as tanning. So if we get exposed to sunlight and suppose a part of the body is exposed and a part is covered, the exposed part get little darker. So to protect us from extreme radiation of sunlight, our body synthesizes more and more of melanin. But here we are talking about a long-term adaptation. If you compare the bears which are found in polar area and which are found around this equator area. So the grizzly bear, which we say they have brown or blackish fur, where the polar bears, they have white fur. This is again the solar intensity dependent adaptation. Clear? The another important example is xerophyte, that is the plant which are leaves in the dry condition. So xerophytes, they can survive by some adaptation. Let's see. Water is less, so they should minimize water loss. In case of plants, maximum water loss takes place by transpiration, and transpiration takes place through leaves. So in xerophyte, leaves are either reduced or modified into spines. Now if leaves are reduced and becomes a tiny structure, that means number of stomata present on the leaves would be less. If the leaves get modified into spiny structure, then there is no stomata on that spiny structure. So we can take the example of opuntia, that is cactus. In cactus, the leaves completely gets modified into spines. So there is no leaves, and because of this transpiration is minimized. But if leaves is get modified into spine, so other structure has to perform the function of leaves, that is photosynthesis, and that is why in them the stem gets modified into green structure which perform photosynthesis, and for photosynthesis stomata is required. So there are stomata, but those stomata are on the stem, and if the leaves are reduced, the stomata would be present on the leaf and they are sunken stomata. Now what exactly the sunken stomata? Whenever we talk about leaf structure, the epidermis has cells, and here we talk about this stomatal structure. In case of xerophyte, the epidermis will have a bend or a depression, like, and here the stomata are present in that depression, and in that depression there are bristles also. These bristles are going to trap whatever water vapor is lost, and if water vapor is retained in this area, that means there are little moisture, and if moisture content is more, transpiration rate
is automatically reduced. So they have stomata for gaseous exchange. It is required as leaves are either lost or change into spine or reduced. So stomata can be present on the stem or on the modified or reduced leaves, but they are sunken stomata. Clear? Second adaptation related to stomata is the stomata is sunken. They are present in depression, and this plant have also adapted to change the timing of opening and closing of stomata. Normally, when we talk of stomata, they open during day and close during night. In xerophyte, stomata they open during night and close during daytime. This is an adaptation, and such stomata is called scotoactive stomata. Now, if stomata open during night time, gaseous exchange can be takes place, but during night, the temperature is comparatively lower. The rate of transpiration will be reduced. So, plant have adapted themselves. Next, we also talk of camp plants. The plants which live in extremely dry condition, they have changed the pathway of photosynthesis. It is called crassulacean acid metabolism, in which they have scotoactive stomata. During night, carbon is fixed in the form of a compound. During daytime, that fixed compound again releases carbon, and because during daytime light reaction takes place, so ATP NADPH2 will be available for the plants to fix that carbon into glucose or carbohydrate. So CAM is an alternative to the regular photosynthesis, which we will say takes place by C3 cycle. The plants which are always live in a warmer condition, they have also adapted by following a C4 pathway. Normal photosynthesis, dark reaction is performed by C3 cycle. So the plants which show C4 cycle, they have adaptation, that is, they have dimorphic chloroplast. Dimorphic chloroplast, that is granule and agranule, and Crane's anatomy is wreath-like arrangement of thick-walled bundle sheath cell. So these are the adaptation they have, and because of this adaptation, they are able to survive in an area where solar intensity is high, temperature is high, both are abiotic conditions. So because of this adaptation, the animals which live in dry area, the plants which live in dry area are able to survive there. So whenever we talk of response, it is because of these kinds of adaptation. So in this xerophytic example, we talked of morphological as well as physiological adaptation of plants. Clear? Some poikilotherms like reptiles, they show some behavioral adaptation. Poikilotherms like crocodile, we have seen that they keep changing their position depending upon how much heat they want. They are poikilotherms, means commonly we call them cold-blooded animals. That means their body temperature changes according to the external temperature. So how their behavior changes is, whenever their body temperature falls below certain level, they go out in the sun and they just stay there, which is a behavioral changes. And when the body temperature is slowly rise and it rises beyond a certain limit, they again start moving to the shady areas or they may get into the water. So this is the behavioral change. A similar behavioral changes is seen in some lizards, in some insects, when they burrow under the soil to escape from the extreme heat. Okay. And there are animals who have changed their activity time. We know about diurnal and nocturnal animals. So the animals, to avoid this extremely hot condition, they become nocturnal, or sometimes they get active during sunset. And that time solar intensity is low and temperature is not high. So their activity changes, but their changed behavior or changed activity is an adaptation which helping them survive in all this adverse condition. Clear? Now we will talking about the organisms which are living in the extremely cold condition. Here we will talk about some lower organisms. We know at very low temperature, the enzymatic activity is slowly decreased and finally it is going to stop. So if an animal living in extremely cold condition, then how are those enzymes present in the body of that animals are able to function? So these animals have special proteins which are called antifreeze proteins, which helps them to survive in extreme condition. Now the reverse of this is extremely hot condition. If the temperature increases beyond the certain limit, the enzymes would get denatured. But there are certain organisms, like some lower organisms, that is archaebacteria, which live in extremely hot condition. They are even found in hot water vents where the temperature is 100 degrees Celsius. So if they are able to survive there, that means their enzymes must be working in those hot conditions. So they have thermostable proteins which forms these organisms, and the example is Thermus aquaticus, which is a archaebacterium. It is a thermophilous bacterium found in hot water vents, and in this there is a protein which act as enzyme known as TAC polymerase. It is the same enzyme which we use in PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. In one step which takes place at a very high temperature, and we need a DNA synthesizing enzyme. Our DNA synthesizing enzyme cannot work at that high temperature. So we extract this TAC polymerase from this thermophilous bacterium, Thermus aquaticus, and we use this in that process. So they have this special type of proteins. Okay. The next adaptation is mimicry. So mimicry, it is the resemblance of one species with another in order to obtain advantage, especially against the predation. The species which is imitated is called model, while the animal which imitates is known as mimic. Model is either voracious or distasteful to predator. Mimicry is of two types: Batesian mimicry and Müllerian mimicry. So the Batesian mimicry is a harmless mimicry. In this mimicry, the mimic is defenseless. It has, however, resemblance to a dangerous mode, so that the predator usually doesn't prey upon it. For example, Viceroy butterfly mimics unpalatable toxic monarch butterfly. Another example is poisonous coral snake and harmless king snakes look a lot alike. Predators will avoid the king snake because they think it is poisonous. The second is Müllerian mimicry. In this mimicry, equally toxic species mimic each other for the purpose of protection. For example, moth and wasp are inedible and resemble each other. Once a predator such as a bird has tasted a wasp, it would automatically avoid the moth. If bird has tasted a moth, it would avoid eating a wasp. Another example is monarch butterfly mimic queen butterfly. Next, another important adaptation is camouflage. Camouflage is the ability of an organism to blend with the surroundings or background. It can be colors or patterns or both. So it is the most common type of adaptation by animals to remain unnoticed for protection. For example, many insects, reptiles, and animals. It is difficult to distinguish leaf-like grasshopper or praying mantis from the surrounding foliage. Similarly, stick insect, which are looks so much like a twig, and a leaf insect and dead leaf butterfly cannot be noticed unless and until they show movement. So camouflage is protective to animals which are preyed upon by others. So these are some important adaptation which are found in organism, which helps the organism to cope up with the various adverse condition of the environment. So when we talk of responding to abiotic condition, it is actually because of all these kinds of adaptation. So that's all for today. Thank you.